So we continue. And now we start to more seriously look at the endpoint map. And I would like to write it in such a way that we can really operate. And to this end, it's always better to deal with a linear object than with points on the manifold. And I can take just, I would like to, so we have our system, f u of t of q. And actually, we can even consider this endpoint map, and and we associate to u of dot, we associate q of t. Q of t. This is a ft, as you told. But actually, first thing I would like to show that it is somehow a smooth map, in which sense you'll see, from the space of controls, control function, into the manifold. And I would like to do even more general, and at this level, it's not important. At this level, u just parameterize vector fields, and we may consider that map as a restriction of the following map. We take any non-autonomous vector, smooth vector fields. Xt is a time-variant vector field. And consider equation q dot equals xt of q. It's such a specification of this map. We take and we just consider not all non-autonomous vector fields are specific, parameterized by u of t. And already at this level, I'm going to prove that if we consider the norms, so we associate norm of x dot, k norm is just an integral of, say, 1, t will be in the segment 0, 1. Norm xt, norm ck, say. It says norm ck. So when we consider supremum of all partial derivatives up to order k on the compact, okay, the compacts. Okay, we should write also the compact here, but I will not. I would like to manage. So if you consider such a norm and consider the map x dot into q of t, we assume that q of 0 is fixed. Then I'm going to show that it will be smooth name norm in this topology. Okay. We can also put here p, some integral norms, and it will be still smooth in this topology. I simply find the Taylor expansion of this map, and it will be useful. Since as you have seen, we always study asymptotics for certain family, certain perturbation of given control, so that's a crucial information. So in order to do it, I will study q of t belongs to some nonlinear object for us, to the manifold. Even if it is domain in Rn, it's still equation is nonlinear. But there is a classical trick, somehow dual approach, how to consider it as a linear. Of course, as a linear operator equation, it helps a lot to write expansions. We simply take an observable, a smooth function, A. And instead of Q of t, we consider development of A of Q of t. Okay, that is A of Q of t. And smooth, so you can consider A as a one sum coordinate. So, but it is important that space of function is the linear vector space. It's a vector space. It's a linear space. So, using this equation, we can write it as an integral equation, and then we can write. And this is totally coordinate free, by the way. As soon as this is fixed, this is A of Q0 plus integral of Q dot, okay? Integral of Q dot. But we know the differential of A and Q dot, but we know what is the integral of, what is this differential? This is going to be dA Q of tau and x, so again, at Q, dA x tau, let me write like this, everything is at Q of t. You can write it like this, and as we know, this is nothing else but action of vector field as a one first order differential operator on A. So we can write this in totally linear way. X tau applied to A, and this guy computed at Q of dot. Okay? So then we may do the same trick now let us consider another function. Instead of A, we have another function. Let us fix now tau on the segment 0, t. Instead of A, we have another function, x to A. It's just another function. We can say B. And we can apply absolutely the same identity. Since this identity is valid for all t, for all function, we pay, instead of t, we can take tau, and instead of function, A can take this function B, and we have the following expansion, A of Q of t, equals A of Q0 plus 0t x to A computed at Q0 dto and plus double integral, so second order differential operator, because now we have to apply. And let me write like this. This will be double integral t2 smaller than t1 smaller than t2 smaller than t1 smaller than t. And here we have xt2 apply to xt1, apply to A, and everything computed at point q of t2, dt1, dt2. Of course, we can keep. And why it is a good, what we are doing actually? What in such a way, we write step by step Taylor expansion of our map at zero. At zero in the space of non-autonomous vector field. Okay, so this is a value. If x field is zero, we stop here. To zero. I'm sorry. Zero. We stop here. Otherwise, we can write this guy. This is a linear with respect to x. Non-autonomous field form a linear space. This is a linear with respect to field. And this is just a point. So it's a linear, this is just point. So it's a linear, really linear with respect to field. There are no trajectory anymore. Hidden non-linearity, no, there is no hidden. And then we continue. We can continue, keep calculating. and put here. This is this term is linear. This term is quadratic, but not really quadratic because Q of t was hidden. Q of t depends on x. Q0 does not depend on it, but Q of t depends on it. It's our map somehow. But we again now can repeat the same trick, working with this function instead of original function a, and applying our equation to this function, and at moment t2, and then we have here again Q0, and so on and so on. We have the whole expression. And this is a Taylor expression, not so hard. Each time we will have a well-written remainder term, and it's not so hard to estimate it, to see that it is indeed has order. If we have a k, guys, here, it has order k in some norm. So we are working here actually not in the Banach space, to be fair, but in the Fréchet space. So norm of the result, ck norm of the result, may be estimated in cn norm of the source of the vector field in the norm of the remainder for this expression is always needs more derivative, okay? So we have indeed each time, here we have linear term, here we have quadratic term, so we have, then we have order n term, x, t, n, x, t, 1, a, just n q0, so first differentiate that evaluated q0, we can write like that, q0, d, t1, dtn, and plus and so on, plus remember that which you know how to write. But each time remainder has more and more derivative of x, because here we apply high and higher order operators. So this, and so if we treat this order n term as a derivative of order n, then it is derivative not in the Banach space with fixed number of but in the Fréchet space, okay? So remainder, if you would like to estimate norm of this, k norm of this, then it will be k remainder will have of order n plus 1, but is norm k plus n, okay? K plus n, because we have n derivatives. N minus 1, actually, but does not matter. Because x is differentiated only n minus 1 times. So in this sense, it is a Taylor expansion in this sense, okay? So the norm is not the same of remainder, but even always different. Okay, if you would like to estimate this, yes, of course, n plus 1. So that's, but for the moment, I do not care about that. What? What, why first term is I simply take a of q of t and write it as a of q of 0 plus integral of differential. That's all. Newton-Leibniz formula. So, but actually I do not care about that because what I really, this expansion, it's quite convenient again because it's universal. I also always insist it and depend on particular control problem. But if we have particular control problem, we have a composition of two maps. One map associated to U, F of U, just pointwise maps, and then we use this map. And if F already fixed, we have a normal smooth map in some integral norm for U. And if we have FU here, FU of to N, FU of to, we need to consider composition, then this is, because Fi are always the same, okay, we differentiate our vector fields Fi, but they're fixed, so, and they give you some constant only. Plus O of norm U, say, L infinite norm if you want, but if we depend linearly, it's very general, if we depend linearly on U, then we can take any LP norm, whatever you want. U here will be L infinite in N plus one. So it's a Taylor expansion, quite natural, and can be interpreted well, staying even in the Banach scale if we work not with all vector fields, but with vector fields which depend on finite dimensional parameter U. So we have such an, but this is the expansion only. By the way, for the moment it is expansion only at zero. It's no problem to get expansion everywhere, again, with simple tricks. First of all, I would like to even generalize it. I would like, because no, it's convenient to think about it even in a more general setting. Do not fix Q0. I don't want to fix Q0 anymore, okay? And because it's a well-posed Cauchy problem, why I have to fix Q0. So if I have a U, now my idea to consider expansion. Let me consider, okay. I would like to rewrite it. I can rewrite it in the following way. Let PT is a family of diffeomorphism that send Q of zero into Q of T with, for all Q zero. Q zero just belong to M. I don't want to consider anymore one individual trajectory, but the whole flow generated by the system, by the non-autonomous system. And to write similar equation, it's not a bad idea to think about this non-linear transformation. Again, it's a linear operator on the space of function, quite natural empty operator. If vector field is just derivation in certain direction, diffeomorphism x exchange of variables, okay? I write PA, A is again PTA, by definition is just composition of A and P. Composition of A and P. Then when compute P at certain, PT at certain point, it will be exactly Q of T. And then I can rewrite this equation even without any A as a universal. Okay, with A, I can write like that. That PT t apply to A, A of Q of t is pt apply to A, okay, by definition, it's just change of variables. P A of Q, I can write like that, is A of P of Q. PA, A was a function, P was change of variables, transformation, and composition is another function. Okay? So I can write this equation as A, because P0 is just identity, plus X, this expansion, XTA, plus and so on, erase Q0, work with functions, work with functions. And I can even write a remainder as a diffeomorphism, the same integral of the same type. Plus one. And here we would have P T N plus one composition of operators X T N. Because apply P to some function, function is obtained by consecutive differentiation of A. And then we make change of variables. We compute this guy at Q of T, not at Q of Q, but zero con of T. So this is a remainder that can be estimated also of order N plus one. And at this moment, we can, of course, erase A. Because it's a linear expression. Now it's totally linear expression. Because we just linear, instead of nonlinear linear transformations becomes linear operators. As operator equation on the space of functions, it can be written like that. And we can use such a presentation in order to write everything, how to use it, write everything, expansion not only on zero, but at any point. To reduce actually calculation at any point to the calculation of zero. Actually, of course, the first idea that can become in mind as we compute derivative in another point, take a difference between trajectory. So now I would like to compute the following thing. I would like to compute what happens if I consider the map. We need some symbol to do it. Okay, call it map phi that send x dot into the corresponding transformation pt. So it's the same map as F, almost the same as ft, as this one. But we consider not one initial condition, but all initial conditions. Instead of point on the trajectory, we obtain transformation, how all initial points are transformed, okay? So if we consider such a map, we already know expansion. Then we know that phi of x such a expansion, phi t of x dot has such an expansion. This we already know, at zero, but we would like to have it not at zero at any point. We would like to find an expansion of phi t x plus y t as a series where we have linear, quadratic, and so on, term on, we depend on t. You can put here epsilon if you compute and then write expression is in epsilon if you consider directional derivatives here, but epsilon is not important, just to think about why is small without you using extra symbols. The last because each time we obtain, if we do not want to have a remainder term, we obtain Q of to n. This is what we did, okay? Without remainder term, we do like that, okay? If we do one more step, here we get Q zero, but in the remainder, we will have a Q of t. A Q of t is exactly pt some function b, call this guy b is just b pt, okay? Maybe the confusion is that p is considered in two different ways. Here p is a linear operator, pb. We can better not to put the circle here. Let us do like that. Let us do like that. Okay. This p has different. Here p is a linear operator. I don't want to go too long in this direction. Introduce all the notation, otherwise it will be. I never arrive to interesting stuff. This is just to show that map is smooth. As map of functional spaces, and in principle, we can compute its derivative. This is what I want to say. So here, it's a composition of the map. This pt of b is of at a point q0 equal b of pt of q0. So this is a b of q of t by definition. So what is written here? It's just formal notation, but very convenient for calculation because you can keep calculating. Okay, so it's not a good idea, first of all, in the manifold without our calculation are coordinate free. Without coordinates, not possible to consider f plus y minus phi t of x, but okay, we cannot do it in coordinates, we are not so snob, but even in coordinates it is not convenient, it is hard to get a readable result, because when you differentiate it with respect to t, it is not any more differential evolution equation, it's something it's more complicated if we keep differentiating some complicated differential operators and how to write the difference as a series of homogeneous paths with respect to y, it's not so clear. Because of that, we cannot. It is not at all reasonable and very artificial to consider the difference, but we always can, that is why I do this not in the nature, it's not occasional that I work not with individual trajectories, but the whole flow, because the flow held form a group. So we can consider the following now order, things do not commute. And we control because they do not commute, the order starts to be essential. So I take okay, so we would like to consider the following thing. We consider phi t of x dot plus y and divided somehow, and this is a diffeomorphism now. This is a diffeomorphism. This is not a point on the manifold, but transformation of a point. Okay, And moreover, it's a good idea to consider it as operator. This is operator that send A into, because to have a linear thing. You see that we write our expansion as it would be a linear equation, but it is a linear equation. Let me even rewrite my equation. My equation can be written. This guy, that equation for individual trajectory is the first order PDE. It characteristics. Our ODE is characteristic for this first order PDE. Equation for D over D. If we write A of P of T of PT of Q0, so QT, that dA over dt is XTA of PT of Q0, we can write like that, where XX, first XX, and then we compute everything in point PT. Hmm? So in operator sense, we write at PTA, d over dt, equals equals PT X A just by differential. Okay? First X act and then we make change of variables in X at TTA. Okay? So it's a linear equation. We can erase A because it's for any A is like that. A is just variable. And we write a general equation, quite form, but not only formally, because if I explain in principle, we can control also the norms. And we get a linear equation, okay? And we will consider a separator equation. It's always convenient. This is send A to phi t of x plus y, a, that's what I mean. This in operator sense, it's operator equation. Then, let us do the following. Let us divide pt of x plus y divided as I define pt, for me it would be convenient to simplify a little bit notations, pt is it just phi of xt. I always use such a notation here during my calculation, okay? Pt is phi of xt. So I divide it to pt minus one. It's very easy to write equation also for pt minus one because operator equation for pt minus one. So and this, and that is and that is something when we get in zero identity, because now we're in the group, instead of zero, we have identity element, if y is zero. We have just pt and pt minus one. So we can, so, and but the good thing about such an expression, that if you consider it, how it evaluates in t, it is still solution to ODE of the same type. And we can, so, that guy is a solution of ODE with vector field with not, vector field is not y, but when y is zero, it is it's linear with respect to y, and we can write our expansion at zero. We reduce expansion at any point to the expansion of zero because of that many arguments, many observations I will do later in zero because you more or less automatically can do it, just change your vector field. You have to, it's very natural that CT, CT satisfies the Pauling equations. Let us write CT dot. First of all, we can easily write, let us write an expression for pt minus one. How to do it? It's quite simple. So we can write phi t, p PT minus 1, PT is identity. It's more or less standard calculations when you do with linear equation, but now you do with linear equation, and all differentials are legal, by the way. In the space of this operator space, differentials are legal. Leibniz rule is working. That's no problem. So let us do it. No, I would like to, for inverse, fortunately, PT is invertible because we have a well-posed Cauchy problem. PT and PT minus 1. I write like that, for me it's more convenient. Let us differentiate this identity for all t. We differentiate this identity. We obtain PTX, differentiate this identity. PTX, okay, it is here. PT minus 1, minus 1. And plus pt, and here we have d over dt of pt minus 1, okay? And this is sum is 0. Sum is 0. It's correct or not? What is written here? Yes. Okay. So then we can write it like that. So d over dt. This is invertible, so we can cancel it. And we can write it d over dt pt minus 1 equals to the following guy, the x pt minus 1, okay? X pt minus 1, minus, of course, minus. S operator, but very clear which operator are here. And this is, I will use this formula in order to find differential equation for t. You will see the derivative of t is a sum vector field, not y anymore, but sum vector field. Y somehow changed with respect to by x. So we can, it's just simple exercises. I will not write details. You differentiate this. Okay, let us write it. It's so simple. Let me, instead of d over dt, write dot of x plus y, pt minus 1, plus, and then I differentiate this guy, pt of x plus y, and I have to differentiate this one, so it's by will be minus x pt minus 1, okay? So this is CT, no, I'm sorry, no. X plus Y, PT minus 1. Okay, that's fine. Mm-hmm. X plus Y come linearly. And what else? So, and this is equal to CT dot. CT dot. So I differentiate this identity. It's equal to CT dot. Then what happens? I'm sorry, what is it? This I know what is it. This phi t dot x plus y is actually according to our this is a solution of differential equation with a vector field x plus y. So this is a pt x plus y. And minus phi t, I'm sorry, x pt minus 1. Because when I differentiate this guy, I have only x. Okay? So I take this one. This is a solution of equation corresponding x plus y. When we differentiate it, you obtain the same phi t at x plus y multiplied by x, and then this one. So this is c dot. We see that a term with x, as we expected, because of course when x is zero, the result might be when y is zero, the result must be identity. The term x disappears, and we obtain that c dot equals the following things. I write shorter. C dot equals C, the same guy, C. Then PT, YT, PT minus 1. Now look at this term. This are quite common standard calculations for linear system, but I repeat it because we started with nonlinear, but now we rewrite it as linear system. Okay? So it's this equation of the same type. We have diffeomorph family of diffeomorphism, flow, derivative family of diffeomorphisms, treated as substitution of variables, and this is vector field. That's you can check it, that this is just nothing else than pt minus 1 star yt. This is a good exercise for you to check, but you can imagine, because p is a X is a element of the space of linear operators, okay? P is a change of variables in the space. If you change variables in the linear operator, you have a similar matrix, similar operator, okay? And that is what is here. You have a similar operator. And similar is again a vector field. It's just change of what is here, it's just change of variables in the vector field. You have to be careful with 1 minus 1, but it is like that. That you can check, write, remember all the definition, it is like that. So C dot is going to be ODE, linear with, right-hand side is linear with respect to Y. So we have a C dot equals C. And here we have another vector field, not y, but y is changed by x, change of variables by x. Very natural. So if we divide it, very natural. And you can write expansion for that because the result is, and here you have a pt star minus 1 y. Okay? Pto. Write it without arguments because it's for all t. Or you want to write it for t or to as you want. So what we have now, phi of x plus y is p. Now we would like to find expansion with respect to y. How we wrote it? Coming back to phi. This is ct pt. Pt does not depend on y, only on x. Okay? So we obtain this ct. Add something, and pt. Okay? So what we get here? This does not depend on y. And here we compute PT is an image of x for our map, okay? And we compute expansion that, of course, start from PT now. We perturb x, and we get expansion that start from PT. Y is zero, but the expansion of this we already know. Expansion of this we know. Right-hand side is linear with respect to our perturbation, we already know. So we translate, so in our setting for nonlinear equation, we cannot take a difference of solution, but we can multiply, so we have a group. You think about it as a huge group of diffeomorphisms, of flows, group of flows even. And of course, we may translate things to union, just dividing by element. That's what we do. So it can be computed also here. So it is indeed smooth, and in principle, you can write expansion. Let us now do it, think a little bit about it, come back in order to not make more complicated notation, x, y, p, too many. Let us come back to the expansion in zero, because expansion in any point is obtained like that. I repeat that P is just a change of variables, so you take expansion of C and make change of variables by P, very natural, just another variable. It's a trick which people all the time use, working with nonlinear ODEs and PDEs. If you want to have a good in celestial mechanics since 19th century or maybe even 18th, if you would like to have a good controlled asymptotic expansion, you do it by change of variables, not by taking difference, but always change by changing variables to kill low order terms. To kill low order terms, you change variables. So it's essentially what we do here abstractly and formally, and to show that it is indeed only way that can work well. Otherwise, you cannot control anything. okay, so now I let me consider this expansion, identity plus. Or even we may evaluate it, okay, identity plus pt of x equal this. You can erase. F was specification, but for the moment I still do not need specification to explain, to understand some formulas. Pn xt1 dt1 dtn. So I write something which does not have operator leads okay, but it's just a series of operators of more and more high order. So in order to compute something, I have applied it to some function. I compute some variable. but assume what I would like to explain. No first term, I'm sorry. You do not correct me. X dot is identity plus integral x to dto plus and so on. So we have some formal algebraic equation. Anyway, first term, so we have a flow. And maybe we would like to compute this flow at some particular point. Then we have a trajectory. And some strange series of operators. Of course, you may compute this operator also in some particular point. It means that you apply it to function and then compute function at this point. We can do it formally, but it does not give you expansion of of Q of t. This is Q of t. Written like that, it does not give you expansion of Q of t. It gives you first term is okay, that we already discussed it. First comment, just average velocity. It's where we go really, if it is not zero. Now one more tool in all the story. Purely algebraic, since we are succeeded to write such an algebraic way, purely algebraic tool is like that. Assume that this guy is zero. This guy is zero. Then I claim that what is written here is equal that you can even write. Look, please. This integral t1 smaller than t, x t2 x t1 dt1 dt2, you can write it write in symmetric and anti-symmetric part, you can present it this way. It is going to be product square of average guy. And plus integral, just symmetric and anti-symmetric part of x to 2, x to 1, at q0. Here, since it is vector field, not just operators, commutator, I can write it like that. So it's operator of second order, that's true, but if this one, computed at q0. If this one is zero at q0, if average is zero, then this disappears. We know that if principal term is zero, that second order term must be a vector field. And we explicitly compute this vector field. Okay? Actually, we can continue like that, but applying tool from Lie algebra. You expect that if some n minus one terms are zero, that n term is the velocity of your trajectory, and it should be vector field, some combination of bracket of this. This is a purely algebraic expression, as you see. And using some standard tool from Lie algebra, you can show, actually, it's a absolutely universal property. Even without assumption that previous guy is zero, you can present it as a bracket and quite specific concrete brackets. Quite concrete brackets, so vector field. Simply substitute all products by bracket and divide it by one over n. This is a projection on all polynomials of non-commutative variables. We may consider them just as non-commutative. We are getting more and more general, but in the good way. So every moment we can go down, apply to some function, compute, instead of xt, getting fu. It's a formalism, but you immediately compute things for your. It's not just abstract, more abstract thing. It is the same story. Simply, as we do in mathematics, economy something you're thinking, because when you need just algebraic manipulation, forget about all other information, a lot of information, the vector fields, norms, controls. But for algebraic mismatch, forget about it. Think about them as non-commutating variables. So this is, of course, what I do. It's not the same, but plus some polynomial on low order terms. As example, I show it for second order terms, but it's always like that. You can write the product any word with non-commutative variables. For us, it's important that this guy do not commute for different times. Otherwise, we do not produce anything. Polynomial of low order terms. So it's its algebraic property from Lie algebra. And okay, but if previous term is, if it's just, we do not specify Q0, nothing, purely algebraic property. But now if we specify Q0, take one individual trajectory such that this low order terms vanish at this Q0, then principal term has the specific bracket term. I already showed in the first lecture that example we set sort of the bracket, I wrote this. But it is always like that, okay? Principal term is vector field. Moreover, with this algebra, we already know expression for that. No expression. And this is a good deal. And with that trick, we can do it not only at zero, but we can do it perturbing non-zero vector field also. So that is what I wanted to say. Plus something smaller. Of high order, something of high order. Now I erase and look more carefully on the bracket. I formulate the theorem. So with this calculations, we can see what kind of controls, what kind of non-autonomous vector fields allow us to go in the direction of some bracket. We have to select controls such that these terms are zero. And actually, it's sufficient to consider bracket terms of zero because it's induction. If first is zero, then second is written as bracket. Okay, so also second is zero, then third is written as bracket, and so on. We can try to understand. It's complicated, but very important set of vector fields, or more specifically controls, which make it vanishing all the guys up to order on. That starts to be operationally deep, complicated, and so on. give us some specific algorithmic even way to go in certain direction of brackets. Approximately, always approximately. We go very slow because it's high order, if x is small, and the expansion work when x is small, that this is a x of order epsilon, that this is a epsilon n. We go slow. We go slow. But, and approximately, more or less the picture is clear. We may go in some, but now for the moment, forget about the expansions. Playing a little bit geometry, not only algebra, that is a very general, but something not so easy to directly apply. Play a little bit with simple geometry, and I am going to prove, come back to the control system, to the control system, yes, Q dot equals FU of Q. And let us consider just, it's totally, it can be done in nonlinear setting, and I don't want to make any assumption about dependence on U and of the nature of U. For me, let U will be just a set of indices. If U is a set of indices, I still can use piecewise constant control, okay? I can go sometime using U1, sometime then using U2, the U2, then U3, and so on. When I fix put guy here, I have a just autonomous time invariant ODE. I do take a corresponding flow on parametric group. Then I switch to other. This, everything is well defined with piecewise constant control. And as you can imagine, it's hard to write expansion, but we know that Lie brackets are crucial. Lie brackets are crucial. and I'm going now to prove the following very, very general result. That is observation by Kriener, Kriener theorem. Now, my idea not to write expansions, but try to go exactly in the desired point from Q0. And the general result says the following. Very general, it almost nothing is needed. Just family, what we have indeed a family of vector fields, but we allow to ourselves to switch from one field to another time to time, obtain some set. Theorem says that consider Lie of our family FU. That is just a linear Hall of all iterated brackets, FU1, FUK. Lie at point Q0 in particular, and any point we can compute it, evaluate at Q0. So all linear bracket, K is 1, 2, and so on. All possible brackets. And the theorem says that that if Lie Q0 FU, this Lie Q0 of U is a subspace in the tangent space Q0 M, okay? We compute vector fields, a bracket of vector fields, the vector fields themselves, and evaluate them at Q0. If very general result, but as you see, the proof is simple, nice and simple. I have time to explain it, and maybe I start even I explain and then give a corollary, which says this, give us sufficient condition to get all the points. In such a, by the way, in such a setting, of course, we do not have a chance to play only with Lie bracket. We do not have a chance always to get all points from Q0. Because there could be, okay, so let me explain. We consider this linear Hall, and main assumption is if Lie Q0 FU is the same as the whole vector field, so by brackets we can get all direction available by brackets, at least at the level of linear Hall. But a linear combination of then maybe I need a, let me call A T of Q0 the points when I can get all the points Q of T. It's called attainable set. I need some terminology. T U of dot, where U of dot is just piecewise constant. So that you can apply it always for any dependence on U, piecewise constant. Okay? So Q of T of U of dot, values where we can arrive in moment T switching in arbitrary way from one dynamics to another, okay? That's attainable set. We have starting point Q0 and we can go somewhere. And the statement is So if it is like that, we have more general statement, we do it even for any Q. Okay, let us be for any Q. Actually, we can work locally. It's somehow a kind of local result. If linear hull of all brackets is full dimensional at Q0, of course it's full dimensional in the neighborhood. So it's not a big difference, actually, if it will work. And we can even think about manifold as a smaller neighborhood. Then I claim that AT has interior points, and moreover, it is closure of its interior points. It has everywhere the same and full dimension. Then A interior of AT is not empty. So if brackets are full dimensional, then also attainable set is for that. For any T, then for any positive T. For any positive T. And moreover, AT is contained in it's the closure of interior point. So it may be the whole neighborhood. It may be kind of a manifold with a border, but the border may be included. Or not, this is AT, I write an AT. Or it can have a cusp. It can have a cusp. But you can have things like that, say, of different dimension. Pieces of different dimension, this is forbidden. It's everywhere full. So each point is reachable point, is reached from interior as a limit of interior point. So this is a result. Now let me explain for it such a generality. Looking only on Lie, I explain the proof of this. And the next step, perhaps at the beginning of the next lecture, I will study the situation, try to characterize the situation when we have a complete controllability, starting from this result. But in general, we can do not have a chance to get everything, to characterize complete controllability. It's already a lot. But to characterize complete controllability, looking only on Lie algebra. In particular, let us consider the following situation. For us, it's very important. For this course, it's very important. Q dot is f0 of Q plus sum of ui fi of Q, okay? And ui, say, bounded. Ui smaller than some constant. We compute brackets. But the bracket does not say anything. It computes only linear hull about the force, about the length of this vector with respect to this one. So if f0 is much bigger than fi, if f0 is like that and fi are not so big, then all these velocities are contained in the cone. This is a cone, is a f0 plus sum of ui fi, where ui is smaller than c. So if we have a affine system, and normally we have a affine system, then the free term is dominating, then of course we do not have a chance to. Actually, this cone is quite low dimension, but the real linear hull, real image is of small dimension, but there is a full dimensional cone where all velocities are contained all the time. Okay, so we just have a strong drift we have in one direction, and they do not have a chance to come back if it's strong everywhere. It may be even constant vector field. you take any linear system at very big constant vector field, and it moves it far. But also in this case, if brackets are have full dimension, then we guarantee that entry is not of untenable set is not empty. That's a very, very important property. It's universal and very important. Why it is like that? Why it is like that? Some small lemma observation. We have our manifold M and this submanifold N and M. Submanifold N of M. The proof is based on very simple observation. Assume that and we have two vector fields, say. Vector field F and G. They defined everywhere F and G. Some property, simple property of brackets, F and G. And assume that F and G restricted to N, F of Q and G of Q belong to T Qn for any Q belongs to N. So it's tangent. Assume that two vector fields are tangent to submanifold everywhere. Okay? Then I claim my lemma says that then also bracket is tangent. So this lemma, bracket is tangent. Why? Let me explain. So first of all, if I solve my equation with some linear combination of F and G, starting from N, then trajectory, at least for small time, stay in N. For small, if n is compact, it's forever stay in n. If n is not compact, then it can leave n through the border. Stay in n. Why? Because, okay, you have a vector field that here it is good to think with manifold, because even if ambient space was Rn. We have a manifold, and we can think about F if it's vector field. You don't need any calculations to show that. It's just a correctness of Cauchy problem. Perhaps I will finish with this lemma and the proof and start next lecture with the proof of Kreener theorem based on this lemma. Okay, because I do not have time, and this something which I would like to explain well. So the trajectory for if you take any combination, any control, that is combination, if you consider system Q dot is say U of T F of Q plus V of T G of Q combination like that, then trajectory which stay in N, at least for small time. Why? Because you can think about this vector field if you are sitting in N, you can think about this vector field as a vector field on N. You can simply forget for the moment about ambient space. It's a well-defined vector field on N. You have a tangent vector to N at any point. So your Cauchy problem is well defined. So there is a unique solution of this system in N. Okay? There is some solution of this system in N. It's the curve on N. But I say that this solution is unavoidably solution but it is also solution of the system in M. Because it satisfies the same equation. And we know that there is just unique solution from the given point of a big system on MM. It means that solution, because that solution, it's almost tautology, but give great result. But now go to bracket. Let us consider, as I did at the first lecture, U of T, V of T, such that when you take a primitive, it gives you with zero average. Assume that u of t dt on, okay, we can take epsilon, okay, u of t of until the one, ut dt equals v of t 0 to 1, dt equals 0, with zero average. put epsilon here. Put epsilon here. And consider this curve, the curve which is q of 1 time 1 epsilon uv, okay? Controls, such a curves. You have a curve here. You have a curve here. And compute it at time 1. So you have a trajectory, and for any epsilon and time 1. Now we take a curve which depends on other parameters. Time is always epsilon. Time is always epsilon. And is always epsilon. But it follows 1, I'm sorry, time is always, I'm very sorry, time is always 1, but trajectory, but control depends on epsilon. We simply shrink it. For any epsilon, we have a point in our manifold, because trajectory belongs to the manifold, okay? When epsilon, and this is going to be, call it the curve phi of epsilon, okay? This point, this is phi of epsilon. Of epsilon. So we have a curve of epsilon on our submanifold Q0, and curve when epsilon is 0, we arrive at the original point, and we know how to compute expansion. Okay. How to compute expansion. This curve is this phi of epsilon is Q0 plus epsilon square. First order term is 0 because average of control is 0. And here we have an area, as you remember. We can recover what I told in the first lectures from our expansion, from second term of our expansion. Area of curves, that the primitive of our, this is curve of gamma of t. This is gamma, this is integral of u, integral of v from 0 to t, gamma of t, dt. And this is a gamma, area of gamma. We have a lot of choice of here, and here we have f1, f2. Of Q0 and plus of epsilon cube, okay? So this is actually tangent vector, as I already mentioned, to our curve. The whole curve stay in N, and tangent vector also belong to N. And this is exactly what I told. If a couple of vector fields are tangent to submanifold, then their brackets are unavoidably tangent to submanifold. And iterated brackets tangent to submanifold, so I repeat, I take control with zero average, go time one, and since trajectory must belong to my, this is something which is obtained from control, it looks like that. This curve with parameter epsilon. I get with control with average 0 multiplied by epsilon. So for each epsilon, I have some point. When epsilon go to 0, I shrink to 0. And since average is 0, then the tangent to this curve is bracket. And I have a lot of controls, of course, with non-zero area. Any choice is fine. So I obtain that f1, f2 belongs to it. Okay, so I stop here because my time is over. And start with this simple lemma. I start next lecture with proof of Kreener's theorem. Then I immediately give sufficient condition for complete controllability and some stable properties of the complete controllability. So. And we go ahead. We will have a lot of information of controllability. And then also I will have time, not my, no, I'm not sure that from the next lecture, but on the last lecture, to discuss seriously optimal control. Okay, thank you.